The subject of atomic physics. Lecture number 11. SEM. Quantum statistics. Lecture plan. First, indistinguishability and quantum statistics. Quantum distribution functions. Second, comparison of the distribution functions. The specific head of a crystalline solid. Third, the Boltzmann distributions as an approximation to quantum distributions. The laser, the photon gas, the phonon gas. As the number of constituents of the physical system increases, a detailed description of the behavior of the system becomes more complex. Thus, as we proceed in our studies from one electron atoms to multi-electron atoms, and then to molecules, and finally to solids, we anticipate increasing complexity and difficulty in treating in detail these systems. For a familiar example, consider what will be involved in trying to describe the motion of one molecule of a gas in a system containing a liter of that gas under standard conditions, containing approximately 10 to 22 power molecules. Fortunately, it is generally unnecessary to have such detailed information to determine the most important properties of this system, that is to determine the measurable properties, like the pressure and temperature of a gas. Furthermore, the more complexity of a system containing a large number of constituents is often responsible for many of the simple properties that we observe, as we now explain. If we apply the general principles of mechanics, such as conservation laws, to a system of many particles, we can ignore the detailed motion or interaction of each particle and deduce simple properties of the behavior of the system from statistical considerations alone. In fact, even an elementary statistical approach enables us to describe and explain to a wide range of physical phenomena and give us a good deal of insight into the behavior of real physical systems. The reason is that there is a relationship between the observed properties and the probable behavior of the system. If the system contains enough particles for statistical considerations to be valid, consider for instance an isolated system containing a large number of classical particles in thermal equilibrium with each other at temperature T. To achieve and maintain this equilibrium, the particles must be able to exchange energy with each other. In the exchanges, the energy of many one of the particles will fluctuate, sometimes having a larger value and sometimes a smaller value than the average value of energy of a particle in the system. However, the classical theory of statistical mechanics depends on the energies successfully assumed by the particle or the energies of the various particles of the system at some particle time, be determined by a definite probability distribution function called the Boltzmann distribution, which has a form from that depends on the temperature T. Knowing the probabilities that the particles of the system will occupy the various energy states, we can then predict a variety of important properties of the entire system by using these occupation probabilities to calculate averages over the system of the corresponding properties of the particles when they are in those states. The Boltzmann distribution predicts the probable number of particles in each of their energy states for a classical system containing many identical particles in thermal equilibrium at a certain temperature. It is a fundamental result of classical physics, not quantum physics. Nevertheless, it is frequently used in discussing quantum physics, as we have seen before and shall see again. For these reasons, we have included two quite different arguments that each led to the Boltzmann distribution. Our first argument involves counting the number of distinguishable ways the identical entities of the system in thermal equilibrium can divide between them the fixed total energy of the system. The Boltzmann distribution follows from assuming and all possible divisions occur with the same probability. In this pressure, an energy division is counted as distinguishable from some other division if it differs from that division only by a rearrangement of identical entities between different energy states. That is, identical entities are treated as if they are distinguishable in such rearrangements. In the second argument, leading to the Boltzmann distribution, we assume that the presence of one entity in some particular energy state in no way inhibits or enhances the chance that another identical entity will be in that state, and again that is possible, all possible divisions of the system's energy occur with the same probability. In quantum statistics, particles which are described by antisymmetric eigenfunctions are called fermions, and particles which are described by symmetric eigenfunctions are called bosons. That is, the eigenfunction for a system of several identical fermions changes sign if the labels of any two of them are exchanged, while the eigenfunction for a system of several identical bosons does not change sign in such a label exchange. These names honor two physicists, Fermi and Bose, who were prominent in the development of quantum statistics. The fact that one fermion prevents another identical fermion from joining in the same quantum states, it has the exclusion principle, and certain of its extremely important consequences is sometimes something we are familiar with from our study of multi-electron atoms. This can be described somewhat formally by saying that if there are already n fermions in a quantum state, the probability of one more joining them is smaller by an inhibition factor of 1 minus n than it will be if there were no quantum mechanical indistinguishability requirements. We have not had occasion to show that the presence of one boson in a quantum state and hence the probability of a second identical boson being found in that state, because we have done little with bosons since developing the quantum mechanics of indistinguishable particles. Let us show this now. Consider the symmetric eigenfunction for a system of two identical bosons. Recall that psi sub alpha of 1 means the particle labeled 1 is in the quantum state alpha. Psi sub beta of 2 means particle 2 is in the state beta etc. And that also particle labels are actually used measurable quantities like the probability density T sub S interstar Psi sub S have values which are independent of assignment of labels to particles. Recall also that force is normalized by the normalization factor 1 divided square root from 2 if we assume that psi sub alpha of 1, psi sub beta of 2 and psi sub beta of 1 multiplied psi sub alpha of 2 are normalized. Now we place both bosons in the same state, say the state beta, by setting alpha equals beta. Then the eigenfunction is equal. C sub S equal, and the probability density is formula number 1. What will be eigenfunction and probability density for these two identical particle systems be like if we had not taken into account the quantum mechanical requirements of indistinguishability of identical particles? The eigenfunction will have the form obtained directly from the Schrödinger equation before applying the indistinguishability requirements. Let's take psi equals psi sub alpha of 1 multiplied p psi sub beta of 2. This eigen function psi is normalized since we have assumed that psi sub alpha of 1 multiplied psi sub beta of 2 is normalized. For the case at hand where alpha equals beta, we have psi equals psi sub beta of 1 multiplied psi sub beta of 2. And the normalized probability density is formula number 2. It is fair to compare the probability densities of equations 1 and 2 since both are property normalized. Doing so, we see that the probability psi sub s multiplied psi sub s of having two bosons in the same quantum states has twice the value of the probability psi multiplied psi of this situation occurring if the system is described by eigen function that does not satisfy the quantum mechanical requirements of indistinguishability. We can express this by saying that the probability of having two bosons in the same state is twice what it would be for classical particles. Thus, the presence of one boson in a particular quantum state doubles the chance that the second boson will be in that state compared to the case of classical particles where there is no particular correlation between the energy states occupied by the particles. Example 1. Compare the probability of three bosons to be in a particular quantum state with the probability for three classical particles to be in the same state. Inspection of the symmetric eigen function for a three boson system found earlier shows that it contains 3 factorial equals 3 multiplied 2 multiplied 1 equals 6 times, like psi sub alpha of 1 psi sub beta from multiply psi sub beta of 2 multiply psi sub gamma of 3, and that the normalization constant is equal 1 divided square root from 3 factorial. After setting alpha equals beta equals gamma to put all the bosons in the same state, the probability density contains 3 factorials to power equal terms, but it is multiplied by the square of the normalization constant 1 divided square root from 3 factorial to power. So the probability is larger by a factor of 3 factorial to power divided 3 factorial than it will be if there were 3 identical classical particles in the state. The probability for the boson case consequently is larger by a factor of 3 factorial. The results of example 1 can obviously be extended to the case of n identical bosons in the same quantum states and show that the probability of this occurring is larger by a factor of n factorial equals n multiplied n minus 1 multiplied n minus 2 multiplied etc. 1, compared to the probability that it will be occur in the case of n identical classical particles. These results can be looked at from a most useful point of view by answering the following question. If there are already n bosons in a particular final quantum state of a system in which bosons are making transitions from various initial to various final states, what is the probability that one more boson will make a transition to that particular final state? Let P first represent the probability that the first boson is added to the original empty state of particular interest. If the enhancement effect we have discussed did not exist, the probability of there be n bosons in the state will be just the nth power of p first, since the probabilities of adding successive bosons will all be the same, and since these additions will take place independently and independent probabilities are multiplicative. That is, p sub n equals p sub p first and n power. But the actual probability that there are n bosons in the state is enhanced to the value p sub n boson equals n factorial multiplied p sub n equals n factorial multiplied p first and fact n power. The actual probability that there are n plus 1 bosons in the state is p sub n plus 1 boson equals n plus 1 factorial multiplied p sub n plus 1. Since n plus 1 factorial equals n plus 1 multiplied n factorial, and since p sub n plus 1 equals p first n plus power plus 1 power equals p first n power multiplied p1 equals p sub 1 multiplied p first. We have p sub n plus 1 boson equals n plus 1 multiplied n factorial multiplied p sub n multiplied p first. Or p sub n plus 1 boson equals 1 plus 1 n multiplied p first multiplied p sub n boson. Formula number 3. Now, p sub n boson is the probability that there actually are n bosons in the state. So the answer to the question posed. If there are already n bosons in particular final quantum state, is 1 plus 1 multiplied p first. But p1 is the probability of adding any one of the bosons if there were no enhancement. So we conclude that if there are already n bosons in a quantum state, the probability of one more joining them is larger by an enhancement factor of 1 plus 1 than it will be if there were no quantum mechanical indistinguishability requirements. The most frequently used procedure for obtaining distribution functions that are consistent with the requirement of the indistinguishability of the quantum particles involves modifying the first argument so as to satisfy the requirements and then extending the calculation to the case of a large number of particles and energy states. Here we shall use a much simpler procedure that is in the spirit of the second argument. As a preliminary, consider the system of identical classical particles in thermal equilibrium. The particles exchange energy, but they act independently in that one does not influence the specific behavior of another. Focus attention of two particle energy states of these particles epsilon first and epsilon second, and let the average number of particles occupying that be n first and n to second. Also, let the average rate at which a particle of the system that is in state 1 makes a transition to state 2 be r sub 1 transition 2, and the rate at which a particle that is in state 2 makes a transition to state 1 be r sub 2 transition first. Both r sub 1 transition 2 and sub 2 transition 1 are rates per particle. It has probabilities per second per particle. So the total rate at which particles of the system will be making first transition 2 transition is n1 and first multiplied r1 transition 2, since n1 and first is the number of particles that have an opportunity to do so, and r sub 1 transition 2 is the probability per second that each will take the opportunity. The total rate at which particles in the system will make second transition 1 transitions in n second multiplied r sub 2 transition 1. In this, total transition rates are equal, that is, if formula number 4. And if the same is true of forward or backward total transition rates between all pairs of particle energy states, then our average population of each of these states will obviously remain constant in time. But constant average state populations is the conditions that characterize thermal equilibrium. Equation 4 is the condition which ensures that the equilibrium we assume in all of our arguments is maintained. In principle, equilibrium can also maintain by balancing interlocking sets of transition cycles, each involving several energy states, without balancing individual pairs of total transition rates as in Formula 1.4, but there is no evidence that this situation arises in practice. To put the matter another way, for formula can be taken as a postulate called detailed balancing, whose justification is found in the fact that it leads to results which agree with experiment. Note that for formula 4 implies formula number 5. Now the term equilibrium is the average or probable number and first of particles in our classical system that will be found in state 1 is given by the Boltzmann distribution evaluated at the state energy ε1. So n1 equals n function from ε1 equals a multiplied e to ε1 divide kt power, formula number 6. And similarly for n second. Thus, the population ratio has the value, formula number 7. Hence, 5 and 7 equations show that the transition rates per particle must be in the ratio, formula number 8, for classical particles. Now we shall apply the thermoequilibrium condition to a system of bosons. We will write it as formula number 9, where n1 and n2 are the average boson populations of two quantum states of interest, and r1 transition 2 boson and n2 transition 1 boson are the transition rates per boson between these states. These rates can be expressed in terms of the rates for the case of classical particles, simplified by multiplying the classical rates by the 1 plus 1 n enhancement factor derived in earlier. That is, since there are on the average n2 bosons in quantum state 2, when the 1-2 transition take place, the actual probability per second per particle r1 transition to boson is larger by a factor of 1 plus n2 than the value r1 transition 2. The rate a classical particle that does not satisfy the indistinguishability requirements would have. As n ranges from approximately equals 0 for a state which almost never contains a boson to larger and larger values for a state which contains more and more bosons, the enhancement factor ranges from approximately equals 1, almost no enhancement, to ever larger values, ever larger enhancement. To summarize, we have formula number 6, formula number 10, and similar formula number 11. Combining formula number 9, formula number 10, formula number 11, we obtain formula number 12, where we have used 8 equations to evaluate the ratio of the classical transition rates per particle in terms of the Boltzmann distribution. Equation 12 can be expressed as next type, formula number 13. The left side of this equation equality does not involve properties of state 2, and the right side does not involve properties of state 1. So the common value of both sides cannot involve properties particular to either state, but only a property common to both. It obviously does, as the common equilibrium temperature T is found of both sides. Thus we conclude that both sides of 13 formula are equal to some function of t, which is most conveniently written as is 2 alpha power, where alpha equals alpha function from t. equating the left side of the common value we have. Next formulas. Thus, n equals n sub 1 equals e minus open bracket alpha plus epsilon sub 1 divided k multiplied t bracket close bracket divided 1 minus e minus open bracket alpha plus epsilon sub 1 divided k multiplied t close bracket power equals 1 divided e alpha power multiplied e epsilon sub 1 divided kt power minus 1. If we use the right side of 13, we obtain the completely similar result for the dependence of n sub 2 on epsilon sub 2. In fact, this result is obtained for the average or probable number of bosons occupying a quantum state of any energy epsilon. So, we have n function from epsilon equals 1 divided e alpha power multiplied e epsilon divided k multiplied t power minus 1, formula number 14. This is Bose distribution, which specifies the probable number of bosons of a system in equilibrium at temperature T that will be in a quantum state of energy epsilon. The same sort of argument can be applied to an equilibrium system of fermions. For these particles, we write the thermal equilibrium condition for S, formula number 15. Here, R sub 1 transition 2 fermion is the rate per fermion for transition between quantum states 1 and 2. N sub 2 transition 2 transition 1 fermion is the same for 2 transition 1 transitions, and n sub 1 and n sub 2 are the average fermion populations of these states. Because of the exclusion principle, the instantaneous populations of either state can be only 0 or 1. The populations fluctuate in time due to the statistical nature of the processes that maintain thermal equilibrium, and they have average values given by n sub 1 and n sub 2. The fermion transition rates can be expressed in terms of the rates for classical particles simply by multiplying the classical rates by the 1 minus 1 n inhibition factor discussed earlier. With n being interpreted as the average population of a quantum state, 1 minus n is the average value of the inhibition factor, and this is just what is needed here. As n ranges from approximately equals 0 for a state which almost never contains a fermion to approximately 1 for a state which almost always contains a fermion. The inhibition factor ranges from approximately 1 almost to no inhibition to 0 almost complete inhibition in agreement with the exclusion principle. Thus we have forum number 16 and 17, where R sub 1 transition 2 and R sub 2 transition 1 are the rates for a classical particle that does not satisfy the indistinguishability requirements leading to the exclusion principle for fermions. Combining formula 15, 16 and 17, we obtain formula number 18, where we have used 8 equation to evaluate the ratio of the classical transition rates per particle in terms of the Boltzmann probabilities. Equation 18 can be expressed as next type by the same reason that we used previously. We see that the both sides of this equation are equal to some function of t, which we again write as e to minus alpha power, where alpha equals alpha function of t, equating the left side to the common value we have. Thus, n sub 1 equals e minus alpha open bracket alpha plus epsilon sub 1 divided k multiplied t closed bracket divided 1 plus e minus open bracket alpha plus epsilon sub 1 divided k multiplied t closed bracket equals 1 divided e alpha power multiplied e epsilon 1 divided k multiplied t power plus 1. We write last equation as n function from epsilon equals 1 divided e alpha power multiplied e epsilon divided k multiplied t power plus 1, formula number 20, where we again drop the subscript 1 because the same results are obtained for all quantum states. This is Fermi distribution, which gives the average or probable number of fermions of a system in equilibrium at temperature T to be found in a quantum state of energy epsilon. Consider further Boltzmann distribution of formula number 6. If you set the multiplicative constant A equal to E minus alpha power, the Boltzmann distribution is formula number 21. From 14 formula, we know the Bose distribution is formula number 22. And formula number 20 tells us that the Fermi distribution is formula number 23. In these relations, K is Boltzmann's constant and T is the equilibrium temperature of the system. The parameter alpha for a given temperature and system is specified by the total number of the particles it contains. For instance, we evaluate that EA equals E minus alpha power for a special form of the Boltzmann distribution that applies to a system of simple harmonic oscillators, where we define it and sub Boltzmann from epsilon to be a measure of a probability of finding a particular one of them in the state of energy epsilon. The result was A equals 1 divided K multiplied T. If we define it and Boltzmann function from epsilon in terms of the probability of finding any one of the oscillators in the state or the probable number in the state, we would obviously have found A equals N divided K multiplied T, where n is the total number of oscillators in the system. This is essentially the way we define n Boltzmann function from epsilon here, since it gives the probable number of classical particles in the state of energy epsilon. In other words, A is a normalization constant whose value for given T is specified by the total number of particles in the system described by the Boltzmann distribution. So the same is true for the parameter alpha appearing in the distribution. It is also true that the alpha appearing in the Bose distribution for a given T is specified by the total number of bosons in the system, and that the distribution gives the probable number of bosons in the state of energy epsilon. The corresponding statements applied as well for the Fermi distribution. In figure 1, we plot the Boltzmann distribution function versus energy for three different values of T and alpha. Note that this distribution is a pure exponential, which falls for a factor of 1 divided E for each increase of K multiplied T in the energy epsilon. Figure 1, the Boltzmann distribution function versus energy for three different values of T and alpha. In figure 2, we plot the Bose distribution function versus energy for three different values of T. We choose alpha equals 0 in each case so that E alpha power equals 1, a case applicable to the photon gas to be discussed later. Notice that at energies small compared to K multiplied T, the number of particles per quantum state in creator for the Bazet distribution than for the Boltzmann distribution. This is a result of the presence of the minus one term in the denominator of the Bazet distribution law. At energies large compared to k multiplied t, however, the distribution approaches the exponential form characteristic of the Boltzmann distribution. For this range, the exponential factor in formula number 22 overwhelms the term minus 1. This is the region in which the average number of the particles per quantum state is much less than 1. Figure 2, the Bazet distribution function versus energy for three different values of t. In figure 3, we plot the Fermi distribution function versus energy for four different values of t and alpha. Because the exclusion principle applies here, we cannot have more than one particle per quantum state. This accounts for the distinctly different shape of the curves at low energies compared to the other two distributions in which there was no restriction against multiple occupancy of states. Figure 3, the Fermi distribution function versus energy for four different values of t and alpha. If we define the Fermi energy as epsilon sub f equals minus alpha multiplied k multiplied t, so that alpha equals minus epsilon sub f divided k multiplied t, we can write formula number 23 conveniently as n Fermi function of epsilon equals 1 divided e open bracket epsilon minus epsilon sub f close the bracket divided k multiplied t power plus 1, formula 24. This facilitates interpretation of the distribution function. For example, for states with epsilon substantially less than s epsilon sub f, the exponential term in the above equation is essentially zero at low temperatures and n Fermi equals 1. These states contain one fermion. For states with epsilon substantially greater than epsilon sub f, the exponential dominates the denominator at low temperatures, and the Fermi distribution approaches the Boltzmann distribution. Note that in this region, the average number of particles per quantum state is much less than 1. At epsilon equals epsilon sub f, the average number of the particles per quantum state is exactly 1/2 because of the way epsilon sub f is defined. When t equals 0, the Fermi distribution gives n Fermi equals 1 for all states with energies below epsilon sub f and n Fermi equals 0 for all states with energies above epsilon sub f. Thus, at t equals 0, the lowest energy states are filled, starting from the bottom and putting one fermion in each successively higher state until the last fermion in the system goes into the highest energy filled state at epsilon sub f. This obviously minimizes the total energy content of the system, as will be expected at absolute zero temperature. Note from figure 3 that for t substantially less than epsilon sub f divided k, epsilon sub f is nearly the same energy as it is for t equals 0. For this relatively low temperatures, the thermal energy of the system has gone into promoting fermions from states of energy somewhat below the zero temperature epsilon sub f energy to states somewhat above that energy. The population changes are restricted to the region of wide width about equal to k sub k multiplied t, since k multiplied t is a measure of the thermal energy content per particle of the system. The depopulation below the zero temperature epsilon sub f energy is quite symmetrical to the population above that energy for very small temperatures. And so epsilon sub f, which is also the energy where n Fermi equals 1/2, hardly changes energy. For increasing temperatures, epsilon sub f begins to shift downward in energy as this symmetry begins to be lost. At low energies, epsilon substantially less than k multiplied t, where this number is comparable to or larger than 1, the quantum distributions fall on opposite sides of the classical distribution. That is, n Fermi less than n Bos and n Boltzmann less than n Bose if n Boltzmann greater than 1. These features are most easily seen in figure 4, which plots the three distribution functions against the energy ratio epsilon divided k multiplied t for the same value of alpha. These features are just what would be expected from our considerations. Figure 4, the Boltzmann, Bose and Fermi distribution functions plotted versus epsilon divided k multiplied t for two different values of alpha, minus 0.1 and minus 1.0. When n Boltzmann substantially less than 1, the effects of the indistinguishability of two identical particles will have very little chance to manifest themselves because there is very little chance anyway that two particles will be in the same quantum states. So we expect the quantum distributions to join with the classical distribution for n Boltzmann substantially less than 1. When the classical distribution predicts an approximable probability of there being more than one particle per quantum state, it asks when n Boltzmann greater than 1, then this probability will be inhibited for fermions and enhanced for bosons, and we expect the quantum distributions to diverge from the classical distribution in the manner indicated in Figure 4. Table 1 summarizes the most important attributes of the three distribution functions. Next slide. Applied literature. So next slide, questions to consolidate knowledge. First question, exactly what do the inhibition and enhancement factors describe? What are their origins? Second question, what is the basic reason why the quantum distributions match with the classical distribution at energies much larger than k multiplied t? Third, explain why the behavior of the Boltzmann distribution is intermediate to that of the Bose and Fermi distributions. Fourth, interpret physically the Fermi energy epsilon sub f. Fifth, interpret the Debye characteristic temperature physically. Thank you for your attention.